Welcome to Take a Wonder with Shebs, with yours truly, Shebs from Shebs the Wanderer. Today I have the wonderful, charismatic Raha Moharrak. Now, Raha was internationally recognised for climbing the seven summits and became the first Saudi woman to do so.
You will see during our talk what this achievement means to her now, even after all these years. Plus, I spoke with her about her career and her love for travel.
So let's take a look into what Raha had to say.
Hi Raha, thank you very much for being with us today. How are you?
I'm good, thanks for having me.
Whereabouts are you at the minute?
So I'm in my parents' house in Saudi Arabia, my hometown. I usually live in Dubai, but with everything that's happening, I decided to come home a few months ago just to see how things go. So I'm here now.
Okay. How's it like going back to Saudi then?
It's okay, so in general, I don't stay in the same place for long, in general, regardless of Saudi or Dubai or whatever. So it's been a really big shift and a difficult lifestyle. Like, it's been really tough. And I'm not the type of person that just can sit and I'm happy with just sitting. I can't. I have to constantly think of plans and fix things and organize things. But after a few months of organizing and fixing, I'm like, okay, so what do I do now? It's been like a really, really hard mental and emotional like roller coaster. But I try to do the best. I try to stay busy. I try to find things to do, whether it's connecting with people or honing new skills like practicing Spanish or going back to drawing. So I try really hard to not have the days like melt into each other.
Sometimes when I was talking to someone a couple of weeks ago and they were saying they've been living in the States and then going back to their home country, it was a bit of a culture shock because even though you're from that country, sometimes you might not have forgotten, but it takes time to readjust, doesn't it?
I think it's the living alone part. Like, it's if you live alone, going back to your parents' house can be a little bit tricky because you're so used to having your own space and you will always be the baby. It doesn't matter how long you've lived abroad. It doesn't matter how old you are. You will always be their baby. So it comes from love. Sometimes I'm like, oh, you know, they ask me, have you eaten or where are you going? And I'm like, I'm not used to people asking me this. But you know, that from love. So you kind of deal with it. The best thing about this whole terrible time, I must say, like the silver lining in this really unpredictable weird time is personally the time I've taken to spend with my family. Like the biggest silver line out of the horrible situation we're in right now is for sure being able to sit and have a few months with just like family time. That never happened before. Like I can't remember the last time I stayed in a place for longer than 10 days. I can't remember.
Taking it back to your early sort of education and stuff. So what did you want to become? What was your ambition in life when you were growing up?
I've always, when people ask me, when did you decide to be an adventurer or whatever? It was never a when, it was always there. I've always grown up being very adventurous and very bold and, you know, how I like to discover the world. I've always been like that. And I think as I grew, the confidence started to grow as well. The confidence in going out and discovering the world on my own also started to grow. So I went to a average middle class all girls school in Saudi, just averaged, nothing, you know, very normal. And then I went to university. I finished my bachelor's in graphic design, and then I worked in an agency. So very, very like nothing out of the ordinary. And then it was halfway through my last couple of years in the agency where I decided that, okay, it's time to do something like really, really up for me and really that feeds my adrenaline drive and my hunger to just go out and discover the world because I've always wanted to. I think my aspiration has always wanted to live that life of being like... I looked at the personalities in the Discovery Channel, National Geographic, that had adventure shows, and I was always like, wide-eyed, this is such a cool job, you know. So this is, and I never imagined that can actually be my life, you know, going around from country to country, experiencing different things, being a spokesperson to brand. I never imagined. It's such a strange path. I ended up where I wanted to go without even realizing it. And it just, I love that, because it just goes to show that sometimes if it's meant to be yours, and if you put in the time and the passion, then you will eventually find the path to your destiny or whatever you believe in.
If I said to myself growing up, you know, I wanted to conquer certain things like travel, but you might understand this. So coming from an Asian background, you know, you're from a Middle Eastern background, you're sometimes not pigeonholed. You're sort of right. Get a degree, get married, have kids.
I call them the tiki boxes.
Tiki box, exactly, the tiki box. And then have kids, and that's your life. And when you don't want that sort of life and you want a different route, you know, people might question you within your own culture.
When you step outside the accepted job list, you know, list of jobs that, you know, computer scientist, doctor, lawyer, you know,
accountancy,
business consulting, you know, finance. Like when you step outside of these margins, majority of culture and people will deem you a failure or what are you doing with your life? It's deemed
you're not smart enough to do these subjects.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I've heard this. I've heard when I quit my job. I loved my job, but I felt like I had something else to do. When I quit my job, I just started doing my own thing. I was told, like, you know, you'll never be able to make this happen. You know, what are you doing? You won't, and this can never be a life. You get these things. It's kind of like a given in most cultures. And I honestly just, it's because people do not like to think outside their own margin and belief of what is the decent job, the decent life, the timeline. Oh my God, don't get me started on the timeline, the age timeline. Like there's, you have to be married this age. Like it's just like, you have to, tiki boxes. And if you don't, then God forbid.
You've done the 7 summits. Well, where did this idea come from then?
You know, when I look back now, it's been a few years. I'm like, what was I thinking? But there is a step by step to what happened, because it's such a long story, and I'll give you the abbreviated version. When I started off trying to find my adventure, I didn't think mountaineering. I just was looking for something that was different, outdoorsy, and an adventure. I didn't know what it was. I happened to be around people that talked about Kilimanjaro, which was the first mountain I did, and that's where the idea came to my mind. Kilimanjaro, what is that? It's interesting. And then that little idea of wanting to go do my own thing slowly started to snowball into this huge idea of wanting to finish the 7 summits. So it wasn't like, okay, I woke up one day and decided to climb Everest. It was this gradual kind of like slow snowball, but it was unpredictable. And when I researched about mountaineering and climbing and training, I realized that the majority of climbs, the ones that were offered, the ones that were better priced, were some of the 7 summits, because they're the ones that people go to the most. So I thought, since I'm gonna go to these places, why not finish them all? Like, why not? Go do them all. And that's where the idea came, and it got solidified when I was actually on mountains and I was actually climbing and I actually experienced these things. It started to become more of a purpose and a drive, other than just an idea. It grew. It was really like a very small kind of concept. And then
Your sort of ambition, and it sounds similar to mine, because I've conquered the 7 wonders of the world. So when I first did the...
Which one? Old or new?
The modern one, because the ancient ones is only the pyramids. Yes.
So I also finished them all, I think. I didn't realize that until I got to the Great Wall of China. And then I'm like, oh my God, I think I finished them all.
Yeah, well,
so go on, tell me about
you. Well, this is it, you see. So when I first did my first one, I think I was just about, I think we're about the same age. So I think I was just turning 30. And I said to myself, when I reach, I don't know, 70 or 80, and I look back in life, I wanted to say to myself, what extraordinary feat did I achieve, apart from getting a degree, the basic stuff. And I thought, well, why not do something extraordinary and complete all the seven wonders? You know, not many people in life. And I couldn't think of any people from the Asian culture that's complete the seven wonders. And I'm very fortunate to live in the UK, been, you know, born and raised here. But I thought to myself, let's try to do all seven of them. And then, and it became, I think it was like early 2018, I just wanted to do, I had like four left. I said to myself, I'm going to do four of them because I had lots of pressure. And I'm not married, by the way, but I kept having pressure from parents. Are you going to settle down? You know, and it became like a paranoia to me, right? Let's get this done before anything happens. And, you know, I managed to do it. And I've written my book on it, which comes out hopefully this month, you know, hopefully to inspire the next generation of, you know, people from my community, you know.
So tell me what did you start with?
So I started off with Machu Picchu, and then whilst I was in Machu Picchu, I was like,
I loved it. I did it. It's beautiful. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, it's amazing. So I thought, well, why not do the next one straight away? So like a month later, I went to the Great Wall of China.
Amazing. That was my last one.
Is that your last one? So Great Wall of China, and then. With me, it's all about urges. So I didn't really have an urge for like another year. And then the Colosseum was the next one, the third one. And then Petra was the fourth.
Okay.
And then, so which one have we got left? So you got Petra. Oh, Chichen Itza. Christ Redeemer.
Chichen Itza.
Yeah. Christ Redeemer. And then Taj Mahal. So I finished off with India with my last one. And India was...
That's amazing.
It was almost like amazing, you know. It was like saving the best for last. But it's hard when people ask me, what's your favorite? I can't really choose one because it's, you know, how can you choose?
It's really hard, yeah.
Very difficult. They all mean a lot to me. You know, I learned a lot, met so many people along the way. And I think that's the most important thing, meeting people along the way. And then as long as you're changing within yourself and taking it all in and putting it, you know, making yourself as a better person, that's what it's all about for me. So, so I mean, when you've done your seven summits, for example, you've also done the seven wonders of the world, I assume as an individual, you think to yourself, wow, you know what? I've learned a lot in life now. So let's take it to...
It really, I think travel people really don't put as much emphasis on travel. For us, it manifested as seven summits, three, seven, one, wonders, whatever the reason that drives you. I think people don't put enough emphasis how much travel teaches you and how much travel enriches you and gives you layers. Absolutely. As a human being and expands your mind. And I think the best remedy for narrow-mindedness and in many cases, stereotyping and being aggressive or racist or whatever is travel. Because as soon as you travel, you learn to see other people's lives, and you are forced to view them in different lights. Unless you are a completely terrible human being and you can't even see that. But you know, majority of people, when you travel, you genuinely leave. Whether you like it or not, you genuinely live with a new layer of understanding and a new layer of, or a little bit of more of an expanded worldview. And people don't realize that. They think travel is just a silly pastime or a vacation, but travel really teaches you a deeper, profound respect and acceptance of others. And I truly believe that if people took this in consideration when they travel, would be way less aggression out there.
Do you know, in terms of, I said to you that there was a bit of, I wouldn't say obstacles, you know, I was paranoid, maybe, you know, someone saying to me, you know, when are you going to settle down, all that sort. Did you had, you were quoted of saying that your biggest challenge was to convince your parents when you were climbing some of these. Yeah. Just explain to people what you mean by that.
So there were mountains I had to climb before the actual physical mountains I got to, which are the cultural points of view or cultural judgments when it comes to a woman doing things that are, quite frankly, not the most typical thing for a girl to do. So I had to really win my parents over. I had to really try to get my parents to accept my choice in life to be different and to be who I am. It wasn't easy. It was not easy at all, because in the beginning, my parents were like, What are you gonna do? They were just like, what is this girl doing? And it took some time and quite a lot of discussion and a lot of arguments with love. And I say it as is, arguments with love, not arguments for the sake of winning, arguments with love to discuss and to find a middle ground with my parents, to reach a point of view that was the middle ground. Now they are completely on my side and won them over, but I had to win them to the point where they at least understood that this is my choice and I want to go climb these mountains. This is what I want to do. And if people are not ready to accept a Saudi woman climbing mountains, then it's time that they should accept a woman climbing mountains. I shouldn't wait for them to accept me. They should evolve to accept my choices. So it took quite a while for culture, you know, some family members still this day think I'm absolutely insane. And some people till this day criticize and don't like the fact that I'm a Saudi woman doing these things. It's point of view. But in the end, I've become more accepted and celebrated as an athlete in Saudi now more than I did when I started off. And that's a win for me. That just goes to show that there's an evolution and people have expanded their point of view and expanded their minds. And
according to CNN, you're the first Saudi woman to seven summits. I mean, that's an extraordinary feat to have, and it's probably is a bit of an honor to have, isn't it?
It is. It's an honor, and I feel the weight of it. I feel the weight of the responsibility, because
would you not say you're paving the way for the next generation?
So I always say this because I got to the summit physically on my own, but I didn't get there on my own emotionally or mentally. Or it took a lot of years and a lot of people to sacrifice for me to be able to get to where I got. So I always say that the generation before me knocked on the door, our generation opened the door, and the next generation need to go through it. So I'm honored to be able to have even a small hand or a small footnote in the history of women, Arab women or Saudi women, in the evolution of the last couple of years. It's been incredible. So I do take it to heart, and I do really think it's a huge responsibility that I never imagined that I would ever have. But when people look up to you, you are held accountable for how you use that, whether you want to say it's power or influence or whatever you want to say, you are responsible. And side note, I also think that a lot of people who have a very strong social voice are not using it in the right way. They waste their millions of followers' ears. They waste it on silly, ridiculous, shallow things. And I think it's your responsibility. What you put out in the world is your responsibility. So I really think that people should be more accountable for especially people, those of influence and those of power, should be more responsible, especially with the new generation, because what you put out will dictate how people view whether it's a woman or whatever group you belong to. You represent this. You represent your nationality, your gender, your religion, your background. So you should have more of a responsibility.
I know exactly what you're saying there. And do you sometimes feel the pressure then?
I feel pressure to conform or to fit a specific ideal of what a woman should be. And I don't think any human should fit in a box of ideals. I don't think any human being should fit in a single box, because none of us are meant to fit in boxes. Proverbial boxes. We are all fluid. We are all deep, layered, complex creatures. And I don't think, like, a lot of people, oh, she shouldn't be so bold, she shouldn't be so... But who says so? Who says that a woman has to choose between her femininity and being a badass? Like, who says that you have to choose between these two things? I can climb a mountain, not shower for weeks, to my mom's dismay. I can do that. I can be a mountain goat, you know, a absolute monster on the mountain, and then come back, take a shower, put heels on, and be the most feminine girl. No, I can. You can be both. You can be a mom with kids and a busy schedule as a mom, and then you can be an amazing surgeon in the day or an architect or engineer in the day. I feel like a lot of cultures try to, you know, again, section and boxes. And this is the only pressure I feel that is heavy. The other pressure, I take it and I'm honored. The pressure of being a role model, I'm honored to have it. But the pressure to conform and fit in that is ridiculous. And then not to mention the other pressure of looking a specific way. That's a complete different, oh, yeah. Like, that's a complete different story. Like, the pressure, this is ridiculous as well. The pressure for men as well, but it's obviously a bit more harsh on women. The pressure to fit, to look like what is in style now, is insane. Like, you cannot go out and enforce a beauty standard. It doesn't exist. How can, like, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. It's taste. It's a feeling. It's, you can't go off and say, oh my God, you have, because I get this constantly, oh, you have big hair, oh, your nose is too big, oh, you should make your lips bigger. Constantly on social media. And I can't imagine how this would feel if it was a woman who does have major imaging issues. It's so damaging and hurtful, yeah, and painful. So these are the pressures that I feel like I get, that I think is, I shouldn't feel this way. But the pressure of, like I said, I'll take that any day because it's an honor.
Well, I think from success, it can bring, obviously, you're going to get your critics, you're going to get people who are going to follow you for, because they love you. And but someone once told me, they gave me the advice, you know, if you're constant, you're always going to get praised, but not necessarily have to deal with the constant negativity. Try not to listen to them. You just ignore them.
Of course, like, you should take it with a grain of salt, but we are human. And sometimes when you're down and you're not feeling, your shield's not up 100%, and you get a silly, stupid comment on a project you worked your heart out to get this project done, and you put it on social media, and then you get some stupid comment. Come on, we're human. I get this all the time. I work on really tough projects, and then when I put it online, I get some silly comments about my outfit or my, you know, stupid things like that.
Yeah. I always think people who do that, they're either a bit jealous or don't really like seeing people succeed. You know, yeah. They're seeing you progress in life, and it's just, it's a passing comment, as I always say. Yeah. It's not really anything important.
And I think it's a reflection of the peace they have with themselves and the acceptance they have of themselves before anyone else. Like, you, by all means, you're entitled. I always tell people this. You have the right to think whatever you want of me. You have the right to think. And if you're one of the very few handful of people that are close to me, you have the right to come and tell me. But you as a stranger, you as someone that does not have any, you know, input in, you have no right to come and spew your hate and spew your negativity onto to my platform or to me or whatever. It's just, I don't get it. I don't get why people are like this. Once someone had the audacity of saying, if you accept people giving you praise, you should accept people, you know, giving you criticism. And I said, okay, if you accept people hugging you, you should accept people punching you. That's the same concept. Chew on that. Like, let me know how you feel about that. It's just, it's ridiculous to think that they think just because people say nice things about you online or whatever, then you should take the...
We talk about some of your other achievement you've done. You know, you've Emirates Woman of the Year.
Yeah.
You've worked with so many different brands. You know, I think recently you put out a post that you've done an advert with L'Oreal as well. L'Oreal.
Yes, I did L'Oreal. That was a dream.
So, I mean, obviously it's led to so much success. I'm assuming your parents are absolutely over the moon with what you've done now.
Yeah, it's so funny. My dad even takes credit when he shouldn't. It's hilarious. When people ask him, he says, you know, she started climbing because I told her no. And everyone's like, but you told her no. He's like, exactly. I told her no. If I told her yes, maybe she wouldn't climb. But because I told her no, she was stubborn about it. He takes credit for it. It's hilarious. He even takes credit for that. It's been amazing. And I'm so honored and very lucky to be able to take my passion for sports and adventure and turn it into a career, because had I not gone to climb these mountains, I wouldn't have been recognized, I wouldn't have been known, I wouldn't have been able to sign these big brands, because in this day and age, if you don't have a killer PR team and a lot of money to pay people to be famous, then you can't. Then your voice, your talent, your voice, your message, and who you are will get lost in the shuffle with everybody else. So I'm so lucky to be able to turn my passion, in essence, into a career that has led me to having a TV show. I had a TV show last year. We were supposed to shoot this year, but you know, this year has been a tough one. But it led me to where I am, and I always encourage people to go after the passion, not the paycheck. I mean, it's tough. It's really hard, but in the end of the day, you should do what you love. And I know it's a privilege, and I know it's not everybody can do that. But try to find the passion project or anything in your life. Set aside an hour a day to grow it, because you never know, that might lead you, that not might be your crowning jewel in your life or your legacy.
And from all the projects that you've done in recent times, would you have anything that sticks out?
I'm so lucky. I've worked with some incredible brands over the years. I worked with Lipton, I worked with Nike, Adidas, and Chevrolet, and so many. But I think my long-standing relationship with Tag Heuer is one of my favorite, collabs. I've been with them for quite some time now, and they're one of the very early brands to recognize me. Really early on, the Louis Vuitton and Tag Heuer were one of the really early brands to give me a chance to associate with them. It helped my career, obviously. But yeah, I'm so fortunate, really, really blessed with the amount of projects and the amount of collaborations I've done. You wouldn't be able to do it otherwise. Like I said, you don't have a big PR budget. Okay. Unless teaming up with these big brands that puts you on a platform, you wouldn't be able to grow.
It's also important to stay grounded as well, not think, oh, you've done it all. And then that can sometimes be a killer. So when you're grounded, I think...
It's really important to have dreams, but to also have other drives in life, other passions. Dreams are amazing and they are necessary, but you also have to have other passions and other drivers. It's not, you can't just have this dream, and what happens if that dream doesn't happen? Then you're broken. So it's really important to have multiple things that kind of shape your drive, I guess. I can't think of another word, but yeah.
Well, favorite places that you've been to? Is there anything that any place that you've
seen? Oh God, that's tough. If I ever had kids one day, I think that's going to be as equal as picking my favorite kid. People ask me, what's your favorite mountain? It's really tough to choose. Favorite place is really hard to choose, but I'll explain to you what constitutes my dream locations. Okay, so topographic beauty, which is the beauty that's natural, people, food, and culture. So these four things are the things that, if a country has these four things, then it's like, cha-ching, that's my favorite. There are some countries that are beautiful, but because the culture is maybe more difficult for foreigners, and it's difficult. There are some places who don't have really good food, that it's really hard. But there are some gems in this world that have these four golden things for me. And I'm like, heaven. So it's really hard for me to choose. I've been to so many different places, so it's really hard to...
What about then Saudi Arabia itself? That's becoming quite a big spot for people to go to.
I'm so happy to see the the beauty of Saudi Arabia being explored and being shared with the world. Because for the longest time, it was private, not the most easy place to get to for multiple reasons. That's in the past. Now, the government has put a huge effort in inviting guests from all over the world. And the first people's initial reaction was, wow, this is Saudi. My reaction when I did my travel show last year, because it was about Saudi Arabia, was like, this is my hometown. It was such a big surprise for me. The amount of beautiful locations, whether it's mountains, sea, or agriculture, or just desert beauty. It's incredible historic sites like Al-Ula and many, many places. I didn't know they were there. Like, I heard, but I never knew it would be this beautiful. So it's been an incredible, like, unfortunately with COVID, what's happening now, the whole world tourism has taken a huge hit. But hopefully when things get better, we'll be able to invite and for people to come and see it, because it's really it's a gem that hasn't been, it's not flooded with so many people. The locations are pristine. Not many places are in the world like this, that are big countries with easy access. It's really going to change the game in the region, I think, once things get up and running.
And when would you say is the best time to visit Saudi Arabia, timing?
Not summer. Do not, well, because I live between UAE and Saudi Arabia, I mean, they're both amazing. I don't like it in the summer. It's just hot. I prefer now, September, October, November, December, Jan, Feb, amazing time. I would say golden time would be October, November.
Yeah, because not. Then, I think it's the humidity that really.
Yeah, so humidity comes. So September is a little bit better, but still humid. Yeah. October, November are my two favorite months. And then December, January get a little bit chilly. Well, I call it chilly, but when my European friends come, they're like, this is summer. It gets a little bit windy, a little bit colder. So that, you know, when people don't take it the wrong way. I say it's chilly, and then they come with sweaters and they're sweating. And then March, April, it's really nice. By end of April, beginning of May, it gets a little bit humid again. But yeah, the amount of beauty here is just incredible. And the culture. We have such an awesome culture that is, it really has not been, especially Saudi, has not been discovered and experienced as well as it deserves. So, I mean, everybody thinks that about their culture, but I'm really happy that the push to share Saudi with the world has come from the top down. So it's such an amazing change in mentality and change in culture. Like, people want more guests to come. It's really cool.
Oh, brilliant. And when you're not doing anything and you're relaxing, any hobbies that people don't know about that you've got?
Oh, people don't realize this because they think mountaineering. I'm an absolute beach bum. Like, I love the beach. I adore the beach. If any moment I have, if I can, I'm barefoot on the beach with a volleyball. Like, I really, really love the beach. Other quirky things, I collect vintage cameras. So I have a lot of vintage cameras. I try to buy one whenever I travel.
These are like retro style, you know.
No, I have, you know, Rolex, I have Polaroids, I have leather pullouts, I have, like, really those leather ones that go and then you pull them out and then you go.
Where did that first come about then?
My mother gave me a camera. She gave me one little camera, a vintage camera when I was young, and I think when I was in my teens. And I loved it, and I love pictures. I love pictures. So every family has that one person that collects all the videos and all the pictures and all the, you know, travel stuff. That's me. So I think documenting, I think life is such a beautiful journey, and there are so many moments that in you should solidify with videos and stuff, but there are also moments where you should just enjoy it as it is. So I have these two contrasting fields. But yeah, a lot of people don't know this about me, that I really do love vintage cameras, and I'm an old soul. So
it's very quick.
My car is 33 years old, so I really do love old things.
Oh wow, anything vintage, I always say is timeless. Yeah. So it's awesome to have.
I like contemporary, like my taste in furniture is contemporary, my apartment anyway, it's contemporary. But you do find like a vinyl player and a vinyl an old radio here and there. I do like a bit of to mix and match between things.
Any new developments or any other exciting news you've got just before I let you go?
Oh God, it's been an interesting year. Everything has been like, you know, musical chairs moved around or I had lots of projects coming up this year, but they've been postponed obviously for different reasons. I can't disclose them, unfortunately. But the two big dreams I have is one, to get my book published one day. I would really like, because Have you
written the book? Have you?
Yeah. So my father kind of blackmailed me into promising him to write the book if he sent me to. So I promised him I wrote the book. It's a proposal and I've sent it. So hopefully I can get it published. The other really big dream is I want to go to space. I've always dreamt of
space of
flying and going to space. So I've always dreamt of finding a way to get to space. Well,
thank you very much for coming on, Raha. It's been
thanks for awesome. Having me.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate your time. And it's great to know. I mean, we've got some sort of similarities in terms of our pathways and stuff, but it's always great to connect with people, especially from parts of the world where people don't expect people
especially this time, like disconnect physically, but connect with people if you can, like with all the means we have, we should connect more.
Absolutely. And hopefully one day our paths will cross and we'll meet. Properly.
If you're ever in Dubai or Saudi, please let me know once this whole thing gets, you know, sorted.
I will be. Well, thank you very much again.
My pleasure.
There you go, everyone. That was the wonderful Raha Moharrak. Incredible journey she has had up to now. I'm sure there is more to come from her.
And if you would like to follow Raha in her journey, you can get all the up-to-date news by visiting her website, www.rahamoharrak.com.
That's it for Take a Wonder with Shebs. Hope to see you all soon. Until next time, bye for now.